every morning when I wake up, I got the same thing on my mind. It's a crazy world out there, you gotta keep from getting further behind. But you won't find.
And now, as the drivers make their way toward turn number four, they get the signal to show you the most awesome sight in all of motorsports. Eldora Speedway, you wanted the best, you got a four abreast, often imitated, never duplicated, the greatest show on dirt, the world of outlaws.
Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, you
green flag waves were underway.
It's one of the biggest sports in America. With an estimated 1,300 tracks across 48 states, a booming merchandise market, determined drivers, and die-hard fans.
I love dirt track racing.
We've been coming here for probably 13 years, and I'll never miss one ever again.
Hey, I love dirt track racing.
I love dirt track racing.
Dirt track racing is the single most common form of racing in the United States. Year-round, these titans of dirt duke it out on local and regional tracks. The stories of how they started racing are just as unique as the cars and tracks they race.
I bought an old 52 Ford from Jimmy Harkness in about 1967, and I wasn't old enough to race yet. Had a friend of mine do it. And we got along all right, but he wasn't quite as fast as I thought he ought to be, so the next year I took over.
Well, I was about 5 years old, you know, down hanging out with Dad. Tony Reynolds, that worked for my father at the towing service, raced motorcycles and would practice behind my dad's business.
I started racing go-karts at age 10, and where I grew up in Minot, North Dakota, there wasn't, it wasn't like living in Chicago where there was 500 kids racing go-karts and they were on all different parts of the city. You know, we had one track there.
I was born into a racing family. My dad, Russ Wallace, was a winning race car driver around the Midwest. And, it's a deal where you grow up watching him and then you want to do what he's doing.
Oh, I was around it. My dad raced, so I grew up around it. My family was always involved in racing, so it was just always been a love, sport I love.
Grew up racing go-karts, motocross, learned how to ride a motorcycle before I did a bicycle at two.
I've been going to the races ever since I was a little kid. Watched them with my dad in the stands, and then whenever I got old enough to go into the pits, I started helping people work on their cars and finally got enough, money together to where I could start racing.
I started racing go-karts and then moved up to four-wheelers and then ventured into some mini sprints, which is smaller than one I'm in now, a champ sprint car.
I was about 16, I quit racing motorcycles and moved to four wheels and a roll cage, a little bit safer.
I was a sophomore in high school. I had a 53 Chevy and my aunt took me to the Waukini races the year before. And my parents left for a week and when they came back, I had a race car and I rode the school bus for a year and a half because I used a car that I was driving to school to make a race car out of.
While many drivers continue to race at local tracks week in and week out, some drivers make it to national and regional touring series such as NASCAR, the World of Outlaws, or the United Rebel Sprint Series.
Myself, Carl Edwards, Jamie McMurray, we're three drivers that came from the Midwest of racing the weekly racing series on at your local tracks on Friday and Saturday night, to the touring divisions of NASCAR, on into the truck series, the ARCA series, onto the Nationwide Series, and then eventually to Cup.
It takes a lot of money to get to NASCAR. I think everyone would agree on that. But there are several drivers in the NASCAR circuit that did begin on dirt tracks and have been very successful.
I have people come up to me all the time, fathers, and they'll say, I want my kid to get into NASCAR. How do I get into NASCAR? And it's so hard, you know. A lot of it's by chance, putting yourself in the right position. But I hung out with my brother, Rusty Wallace, who is a 1989, you know, Winston Cup champion. And by hanging out with Rusty and, you know, getting business cards from all the people he met, when it came time for me to race, I ended up putting it all together and it got lucky. Started racing in 1986 and it all grew from there.
Championships are a gratifying and momentous experience, but the road to winning them is never easy.
Probably when we really got to going around here was in about 89 when we started running the IMCA sprint cars. It was a limited deal. And I won the sprint car championship in 89, 90, and then won the national sprint car, IMCA sprint car championship in 93.
We felt like we were very competitive to win a championship. We just had to, we knew how to win races. It's the races you don't win that wins championships, and that's what we had to work on. So we worked on it awful hard. We just had an awesome, awesome year, and winning that first one, it's still the best feeling I've ever had. Going into the banquet, you know, you get that check, you get the trophy, you know, you're in the limelight, you now have a championship next to your name, and it's one of the coolest things. And it never gets any easier. You know, the second one was, I felt harder, and the third one even harder yet. So it just keeps poisoning more challenges for you as you go.
Don's focus on the racing, it wasn't any doubt in his mind that he had the ability to do that, and his way of doing things, he just kept doing it, not to be bragging or telling somebody he was going to do it, but he was always determined enough to do it. So I guess once he got in a position where he got to be the champion, it wasn't like it was a miracle that happened. It was something that he planned on doing, and he just got it done.
I don't know, years have slipped by me pretty quick. I'm sure the first one was, you know, pretty special. At least I knew that I'd got established, was going to be able to race a little bit, started traveling all across the United States, and been doing it ever since.
I've won two NCRA championships, three IMCA championships, and a URSS championship, so I've had quite a lengthy career.
Track championships, yeah. And nothing major, no.
Before championships can be won or dreams can be realized, there must be a track to race on. The most critical part of the track is the actual surface. A race is only one night, but working the surface of a track is a week-long process.
It consists of early in the year of shaping the track, making sure there's a level plane from the bottom to the top, run a maintainer, pull a sheet foot around, reshaping the track with the blades, pulling the sheet foot to get the track as hard as we can, so in hopes of it staying smooth during the race. Now, normally we race here on a Saturday night, so Friday night, Friday afternoon, we're here dumping water on, which typically in the middle of summer would take probably 6, 7, 8 hours the day before a race. Day of the race, we'll be up here typically by 7. Dumping as much water as we can on the racetrack, and it's just a process of getting it wet, letting it dry out, getting it wet again. We really keep repeating that right up until race time.
Since the tracks are constantly being worked on, drivers often inspect track conditions in order to adjust their driving style for each race.
Well, when they rework the track, you want to make sure you see that there isn't any spots that they just go and overdo with the water truck. You know, if you're referring to Fargo last night, they tilled the whole track up. They tilled the bottom real hard and they tilled the top real hard, and they kind of disced the middle a little bit. And they watered a lot of spots really, really hard, like coming out of 4 and down the front stretch. They watered it, you know, pretty dramatic compared to the rest of the track. And obviously they were trying to keep the abrasive surface off there. But sometimes when you find them little spots, if you run down in the corner and hit one of them slimy spots, you could take yourself and several other guys with you, and you don't want to be in that situation. So you have to pay close attention when they rework that track that you find the spots that have been over watered or overworked.
The track surface also plays an important role in the number of wrecks that occur during a race.
More crashes I see are on times when the track is more wet. And it could be if the weather, if it has rained a lot that day and there's more water in the track than normal, or the temperature's not so hot, so it doesn't dry it out as quick. And sometimes if a car gets set up a certain way where it tries to glide around a corner, and if the track is wet and sticky, the car's not gonna slide as easy. It's kind of grabbing, it's got more traction, and I see them kind of grab and go over. Or if they are going through a corner and it grabs a little bit more, they try and overcorrect and they bump into somebody else that caused the crash. So I have seen more wrecks and more vicious crashes when the track is more moist, where it's wet, a heavier surface. The speeds are faster when the track is heavier as well, and that probably has a factor in there too.
There's more to race day than preparing the track. Fans enter the gates. Kitchens prepare large amounts of hamburgers, hot dogs, nachos, cold drinks, and other items for the night. Announcers plug in their equipment. Souvenir trailers sell fans the latest in racing apparel and memorabilia. This is just a part of what goes into a great night of racing.
What fools everybody is that we work every day on this track. See, they're cutting grass, and they've done rolled the track, watered it today. Today's Wednesday. They watered it yesterday. They sheep-footed it Monday and watered it. And then we worked on a roller that we had problems with. So, I mean, it's a seven-day-a-week deal.
Takes a lot of money. Good facility. We have a good facility, a nice facility. Those things are the two important things.
Track session. We had to put some more water down, guys. We need you back out on the track, please.
The format of all dirt track racing is similar. At the beginning of the night, track operators will use a draw, point standings, or time trials to divide the cars into heat races. Heat races are short races with the top finishers advancing to the A main. If enough cars are entered into a night's races, a consolation race known as the B main will be run with the top finishers advancing to the rear of the field for the A main. The A-Main is the last race of the night. It's often noted for its large car count and pre-race pageantry, such as a four-wide sprint car salute. There is a great variety of cars raced on dirt. Late models have a steel-constructed tube-frame chassis that gives them a sleek appearance. V8 engines produce up to 800 horsepower in a car that weighs around 2,300 pounds. Modifieds are a hybrid of open-wheel cars and stock cars. The rear wheels are covered with fenders, while the front wheels remain uncovered. Factory and pro stock cars are generally built by the major automobile manufacturers that have been modified for racing. While they may look the same, there are a number of differences between the two classes.
Bigger motors, you can do more with them. You got weight jacks on all four corners of the car. You can run a three-link versus just a stock rear-end setup, bigger tires.
With some classes being able to achieve 140 miles per hour, sprint cars are some of the most popular and exciting classes to watch and race.
I suppose sprint cars, they're the most exhilarating. The other ones are pretty technical, and you make them fast by learning how they work. These, you just hope you learn how to make them go and hope for the best. These are exhilarating, they are.
Well, you got two different size tires on the rear, you know, which is staggered, and it turns the car by itself, you know, driving two different size tires. And then the steering is a whole lot quicker, you know, and then you have the big wing on top. That puts a whole lot of downforce on the car and helps you get traction, and unlike a regular car.
Would you catch me in a dragster going 300 miles an hour in 4 seconds? No way. Would you catch me in an F1 car going 200 into a corner, a break? No, you wouldn't see that sort of stuff. But I think the other racer's perception of these cars is they're like a rocket ship with a wing. And that's basically what they are. To have an everyday fan go out and be able to ride in one, I think they get the ride of their life. There are times when I feel like you get things that good and that fast that you are out of control, but it's our job to try to control it the best we can. And it is fun. It's a form you get in every night, even if it's day to day and you've been out of the car for 8 hours and you get in it, your first the first time you hit the gas, it's like, whoa, that's, you know, it's like a shiver up your spine. So if you can get that 85 races a year for 15 years and still have that feeling, that's cool. That's what it's all about.
Even before they leave for the track, drivers and crews spend a great deal of time preparing their machines to race.
Getting ready to go to the track, you're probably going to spend, if you do it all in one night, which it's hard to do in one night, you're probably going to spend about 6 hours on it at least. I don't like doing that. I'll do a little bit every night, and the way you don't have to rush that one, that last night. I don't like doing that. Too much stuff can go wrong, find something wrong you didn't see before. But there's a lot of prep that goes into a car, a whole bunch.
I spent almost 6 hours on the car this morning, just maintenance. Checking everything, make sure there's nothing loose, nothing's came loose, nothing's going to break and crash you. And I like washing it by hand with a mitt because I can see everything then, and it just, and it's kind of relaxing time. I enjoy it. But you'll spend an average of 6 hours per race before you go to the race. And if you crash, you're going to spend a lot more time.
They have their regular day jobs, and then they go to their garage or their shop, wherever they keep their car, and they'll work an extra 6-7 hours a night getting that car ready for the next week so they can be out here for the next Friday or Saturday night to run. Each of these drivers, you know, you got to have pit crew members that'll make adjustments for them, adjust the pitch of the wing to fit the different night, you know, your tires for the track, you got to prepare that if they need to be stripped or smoothed out, whatever needs to be done. There's a lot of work and a lot of prep that goes into the different races.
Time spent on the road and away from their family takes a toll on the drivers as well.
You know, you get sort of tired of the traveling and things like that. I've been doing it so long that I still do enjoy the traveling. It is tough. You know, there's a lot of things this circuit hasn't allowed me to do. I don't think I've ever made it to a high school reunion or any kind of reunion. So, you know, your whole summer is just taken up. You don't have any time to do anything else but race. So racing's not only your sort of your life and your job, but it's also your hobby too.
The schedule, it can be long and grueling, especially into the summer months here. I mean, this is where you gotta find time to relax, time to get away and you know, kind of get away from it all.
When I'm gone all the time, my daughters know what I'm doing, and they get a lot of love from me. I mean, I love my kids beyond belief, and we have a great relationship. When I'm home, it's one-on-one time. Hey, we're going to the movies, we're going to eat. Dad's home, you know, we're gonna go to Myrtle Beach. Okay, what do you wanna do for your graduation present? I mean, I really treat every one of my kids special. I mean, we do everything right. And they know their dad loves them, but you know, this is what I do for a living.
It used to take a big toll when I was in the 80s and 90s when I was racing really hard and early 90s. Now, it's just my wife and I, the kids are grown, and my son's racing, and I have a granddaughter now, so that's kind of stressing me out a little bit.
Of all the relationships in racing, the bond between father and son is the most common.
I get to watching him if he happens to be in front of me. I get to watching him and forget what I'm supposed to be doing, because he is so good at it, he's so smooth that I just love to watch him, and I lose my concentration. I really have to work hard to keep my composure when I'm racing with him.
Joseph and I communicate very well, at the racetrack especially. I'll see things whenever he's driving that he doesn't see. He sees things whenever I'm driving that I don't see, and we'll run it by each other, and it works out real well.
My dad, he raced, you know, before I was even thought of. He's raced for quite a few years actually, and then whenever I came along, he decided to give it up, and then whenever I got old enough, you know, 8 years old, you know, it was in my blood. I grew up at the racetrack every Saturday night, and I don't really think I had a chance other than to race.
You know, my dad never raced anything himself. He was just always a big fan of it, and once we got racing ourselves, his dedication, his work ethic is in my opinion why we're where we are.
You know, we've been racing together for so long that our driving styles are similar, our setups are similar, and if one of us has an idea about what we need to do to the car, the other one is probably pretty close, the same area.
Racing is not just a father-son sport. The entire family helps out in some way or another.
My parents always did a really good job at keeping a family a family. Donnie's a good man, and he's very family-oriented, and we all are like that. In fact, we all work together, and we have lunch 5 days a week, and I don't think a lot of families can say that.
You know, I really enjoy every bit of it. You know, it's a family event, time for me and my mom and dad to have fun.
The family life with racing, that's all racing is all about your family, friends, getting together, enjoying the sport. I wouldn't be able to do it without them. With the support that she gives, with what my son gives, my daughter gives, it's just been... it's been real fun the last 2 years.
Well, I've always heard that a family that races together stays together. And I see that at every track that I go to, when there will be drivers that, you know, their dad races, their brother races, their grandpa races, and, you know, all their wives hang out together. They'll either come to the pits or they'll sit in the stands, and that just makes their whole section, you know, it's like that family section. It's loud anytime you announce any of their names.
My brother Rusty and my brother Mike mean everything to me in the world. They really do. They're my big brothers, and they've always been there for me. They do treat me like the little brother, even though I'm 45 years old. And you know, I mean, they're always there for me. I mean, Rusty literally helped me. I mean, Rusty's the reason I'm NASCAR racing. I owe him everything. My brother Mike gives me all the love in the world and helps me do anything.
It's cool to get that, pass that family thing along to the crowd, you know, say father and son lined up beside each other in a race and see what's going to happen, or getting to talk to them out on the racetrack and talk to them about what it's like to race against a family member. And, you know, sometimes they love it and they love the competition. Sometimes it creates tension within them.
Anything that your kids are involved in, it's fun as a sport. Our girls showed horses. They played basketball in high school, and we took part in all that. So I think every parent enjoys what their kids are involved in.
You know, I remember coming, sitting up in these grandstands as a kid, and what probably fascinated me the most, other than the noise and the speed of the cars, was just the ability they could just put these cars in the trailers and load them up and go somewhere else, was the tear-offs. I thought that was great. I thought it was cool. I don't know what it was about tear-offs that just fascinated me. And you know, my dad had an old helmet from the 70s, and he was too cheap to buy tear-off posts, so he used these long bolts, and they were real long, sticking out of the shield, and you really couldn't put tear-offs on them. And the tear-offs were about as thick as glass. And we used to, I come down here, and a guy named Sonny Mack, who was racing here, gave me a couple of packs of tear-offs, and I went home and took a helmet and tried to get screws on there so that I could put tear-offs on my helmet, and I thought I was the coolest thing on earth. But then I didn't have any mud, so I had to have my sisters mix up a 5-gallon bucket of dirt and water.
And so when he'd race around the barn, we had to get our timing just right so that it would hit him in the face, and then he could tear it off for the next lap.
Bad part was then I had to teach him, hey, aim for my head, because all I ended up doing was getting packed with mud in my chest and everything. It was a lot of fun, but you know, it was probably just kids dreaming is all it was.
I like to think that that was kind of what helped him figure out the tear-off technique.
The number a driver puts on his car usually has special meaning or a story behind it.
It was my dad's number when he raced. Also, it came from my grandfather. When I was a kid and we used to go out to his farm, he had a chariot with the number 15 on it. So obviously it's something that's in the third generation. And when you see that old 55-gallon barrel cut up and with the wheels on it and hook horses to it, you know, that's a form of racing. So the 15's been in the Schatz family a long time.
The number 5 probably come off one of my cars. I've had two or three different numbers over my career, so. I believe 5 was the last one I run, so we just stuck with it, and it was available whenever he started. Plus, when you have to replace that stuff, you only got to buy one digit instead of double digits, so everybody tries to run a single digit.
I started out running 65, and that was my brother's number whenever he raced. And whenever Paul and I hooked up together, we bought the first modified together, and we started running number 3 because him and I both were Earnhardt fans.
79, you know, that was my year I was born. That's how we all got started. We had, as all three of us kids raced, Andy was born in 77, his number was 77, I was 79, and Casey was 81. We were, you know, obviously all 2 years apart.
My dad's number, and he still races, lives in Memphis, and it's always been my favorite number.
There was a guy by the name of Jay Sharrock out of Hutchison, but that car number was 86. My original car number was 81. And the 81 just happened to be on the car when I bought it.
A lot of people thought it had to do with my age, that's when I started racing sprint cars, but it doesn't. It's strictly a family trait to have the 15.
My number was always 74. Of course, I've driven several different numbers, but mine was always 74 because that was my football number in high school.
It's just a number that I ran when I drove for Carl Kinzer. When I started my own race team, nobody was running that number, so I just continued running it.
Mine's 73. That's just a number that I ran all through high school playing football.
And 81 didn't mean anything to me, but that 86, I always said it, when Jay retires, I'm taking that number. And he retired in, God, I don't know, probably 72 or 3 or somewhere along in there, and I took that number about then and had it ever since.
Just like numbers, nicknames and their stories have a special place in racing.
There was a big German man, his name was Bob Miller, and he called me Herman the German.
Well, they call me Joe Bob. I was up there at Clinton whenever Dad was racing, and everybody up there was Billy Bob.
I think that's kind of where he came up with the Kansas Tornado, and it stuck, and I mean it stuck like glue. It's followed me ever since. That was 30 years ago.
Nobody could pronounce my last name. You know, I've heard SC Hats, I've heard Shats, I've heard Sheets, Shits. I've heard it all.
They always called me Little John John. Because my dad was Big John, I was Little John John, and he was Little Hottie.
Since the first championship, when they called it the King of the Outlaws, and after the second or third championship, it sort of started sticking.
You know, Mike Bob, Mary Bob, something Bob in it. And one of our buddies started calling me Joe Bob, and that's kind of stuck.
Any other nicknames? Silver Fox. And some that I won't mention.
Earl Barbin, he was from St. Louis, Missouri. He took a gold marker. And on a black jack, he wrote the Herminator. And I said, I like that.
Nobody could really pronounce my name when I come out here. And when I started to have some finishes where my name was in there, he named me Tequila Shots.
I don't know, before that they had the Hurry and Hoosier and a few other little names, but I think the King's pretty well stuck, and that's pretty well what it's always been.
I can't get away.
I have no nicknames, nor do I want a nickname.
And it's cool, you know, when I sign my name, I put the little tornado out to the side, and kids really like that.
Now I'm Little Hottie, L-I-L instead of L-I-T-T-L-E.
I'm the Herminator, and I like it, it's a lot of fun. It's my alter ego. I put more hair on myself, you know, because I'm a little balding.
Just so that you could relate the word, and everybody thinks there's a story behind it, but I really do not like tequila.
Racing is an emotional sport. Heartbreaks and crushed dreams are a part of the life on dirt.
There was one night that we totaled out 3 cars in one night. Kind of rough night. Still better than going to work.
The lowest point was 1990. First time I ever drove a sprint car. I drove 6 races and had nothing but trouble.
I often think of pitchers in baseball that are out there on the mound in the 9th inning and they blow the lead of a World Series and lose it. They don't blow it, they just lose it. And I could never, it's so hard to live with that. So anybody that's in any type of sports, any type of competition, you have to face those things. So that
I'm thinking every night of the track's a good night. I don't think there's a low time when you're out there with your friends and your family, you know, just out there doing what you like.
While many safety features are in place in the car, the chance of being injured is still a possibility.
Everything's going well. I don't know, we're running 5th or 6th or something like that. And coming off turn 2, the U-joint broke. It knocked the fuel line off the fuel pump. And when that happened, I don't know whether a spark off the U-joint ignited it or whether when I got off the throttle, headers are right there next to the floor pan, and I don't know whether that ignited it or what it was. But anyway, the whole car just up in flames right at your feet.
I'm one that's probably neglected a lot of safety throughout my career. Performance has probably been more important to me than the safety, and I'm starting to smarten up a little bit with when you get somebody killed here or you get somebody killed there or somebody gets hurt really bad, you start to really think about it and try to smarten your mind up a little bit towards that. I've been on fire. I've had bad fires. I've been burnt. Been woke up in the car and not know where I was. I've been drenched in fuel and woke up in the car. There's a lot of scenarios.
My wife has never missed a race. And before I put that helmet on, she kisses me and tells me she loves me. Because she knows at some point in time that, you know, you can get hurt. This is a deadly sport. I've seen too many people die in this sport, not just in the world of outlaws, but in many sprints.
So it broke the drive line. When I got on the brakes to try to stop, the rear end flipped over and tore the brake line off, so I had no brakes. And I'm going into turn three, and I just kind of had to turn the car and slide it sideways to get it stopped. By the time I got that done, the flames were hot enough that it melted the Velcro safety strap on my seat belts. There's a little cover that goes over this Velcro. Well, Velcro, of course, is made out of nylon, and when that heat hit that nylon, it curled it and locked it together. And I couldn't get it off. And it's getting hotter and hotter and hotter, and of course, I had a good fire suit on, and it was doing its job, but they're only good for about 15 seconds. Well, I was in there a considerable amount longer than that. I couldn't get that off, and I couldn't get out of the car and realize, well, I got to take the steering wheel off to get out anyway. I hadn't done that yet. Pulled the steering wheel off. The next time I reached down to get the Velcro off, it had melted clear off. Then I could get my seatbelt unlatched.
No, I haven't flipped, you know, knock on wood, but I just try to drive clean and hopefully everyone else will drive us clean. So we try to stay out as many wrecks as we can.
The crashes, it's not if, it's when. It's kind of like bull riding. Them guys, it's not a matter of if they're going to get hurt, it's when. And it's not so much that scenario here in this type of race. And these guys that build these products, build them to the utmost ability they have. The cars are very safe. And the safety equipment has made leaps and bounds. I mean, they've made fire suits that don't burn. It's pretty amazing what the technology that's come around. But I don't, you know, it's not something you think about every day. You just have to, block it out. And nobody likes to see anybody get hurt bad or get killed, but it's just the nature of the beast. It's anything you do, it can happen. So you just cross your fingers, and some days you pray really hard and hope that you don't have it happen to you.
Some people come running out from the pits with fire extinguishers and water cans and coolers and got me put out. And then we immediately started taking clothes off because the quicker you can get it off. And once that heat gets inside of a fire suit, shoes and all that's real good about heat and keeping heat out, but in reverse it keeps it in after it gets in. So you get that off as quick as you can, and it was, of course, I had been severely burned by that time.
The monetary cost of racing is almost as high as the emotional cost. With tires and fuel, wrecks, broken parts and traveling, sponsorships and creative budgeting are key in keeping the wheels turning.
We've always been fortunate to have a lot of good sponsors. If it wasn't for sponsors, we probably couldn't do it on our own. But there's a few sponsors on his car that was even back with me 20-some odd years ago. So we have a lot of dedicated sponsors and also have some silent sponsors too, you know. So again, we've been very fortunate. We have a lot of good help.
Sponsors, they're few and far between. Not a lot of people like to sponsor due to the fact it's their money that's going out there. And with the tough times right now, it's pushing real hard. I've had a couple of good sponsors. Mahika Trucking out of Garden City. He was one of my good sponsors this year. Davis Restoration here in Sublette. He painted my race car for me. CFL Signs out of Scott City did all my graphics for me. My wife, that's my biggest sponsor. Whatever she says, then I can buy.
I've probably won more races on less money than any man alive, simply because I've always built my own motors. Of course, I have to have machine work done at different places, and Walt's machine and Collier has been real good to me. He cuts me a break on my own stuff. And I build motors for other people. Of course, he charges me regular price for machine work, which I pass on to the customer anyway, it doesn't matter. But we've just built everything ourselves, you know, the motors, the wings. That's how Cody got started building wings. You know, they're $500 a pop, and you know, he can build them for a considerable amount less than that. It's time consuming, but it's no money out of pocket that way.
With running two cars this year, we'll probably spend anywhere between $5,000 to $8,000, and that's out of our pocket, and nothing to, you know, you win a trophy, and it's a trophy's good, but you'd like to see some money back where you got the World of Outlaws, $10,000 to win, you know, the Knoxville Nationals, that's $100,000. If I won something like that, I could do a lot of racing on $100,000.
When the memories from the track just aren't enough, memorabilia serves as a physical reminder. T-shirts, hats, and other items help fans show their support of their favorite drivers, races, and tracks.
There you go.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Guys, have a good time.
It's very important for the sport because the Devil's Bowl is known nationwide. It's one of the largest tracks in the Southwest of its size. And we are proud for people to buy our merchandise because they wear it all over the country. Race fans go everywhere. And then the children love to purchase the little miniature sprint cars we have, or I sell a lot of the novelties, the checkered flags. They love to get in the stands and wave the flag just when the flagman does.
My mom works nonstop from the time the races start. If you guys sit back here and watched her, I mean, it's constant restocking and constant filling, and there's constant t-shirt design. I mean, it's a full-time job just doing this.
I think that we rank in the top three. I mean, nobody can ever do what's accomplished what Steve Kinzer has done and the number of fans that he has all across the country. But I think we rank right there in the top three in sales all the time.
They always have to leave with a souvenir, which always makes us feel good. They want something to remember the races by. And so for first-time people that come out and when they leave, they say, oh, this is our first time here, we gotta have this. I know they had a good time and they'll be back.
Highs and lows are inevitable. Sometimes you win the race, other times you watch someone else take the checkered flag.
My greatest moment is all my wins and my poles and three-time most popular driver and all my stats.
Greatest time was when I won my first race in the factory stock. It was the first race I ever won. And I got out front and I led every lap of that race, and I had about a straightaway lead by the time the race was over. That was a good time. Got back to the pits, you know, and everybody was there, everybody I care about, and that was a good time right there.
I suppose the high point was winning my first URSS race after coming back from near death, you know. That was probably the highest point.
I've been fortunate enough to know the late, great Dale Earnhardt through my brother Rusty and became friends with him. And it was in 2000, Dale Earnhardt was up for a $1 million bonus at Talladega Speedway. And 10 laps to go, we both had bad pit stops, and I pass him on the track, and I'm not thinking, all I'm thinking about is getting as far up to the front as I can. All of a sudden, you know, the black number three, the Goodwrench Chevrolet passes me back. I end up behind him somehow, and he's got his hand up going, come on, Kenny, help me.
Both of us had won heat races. Both of us was in trophy dash. He had the trophy dash covered. There wasn't nothing anybody could do with him.
Except for myself.
I couldn't catch him. We had some hard hitting cars in that heat race, or in that trophy dash. Last lap, last corner, he just gets a little excited, and he spins it out in front of everybody. And we're sitting in the infield, side by side, and he's got a look on his face that's priceless, and he just knew that I was mad and upset. I wasn't. It was still just great to be outrun by your son. I don't know if you understand that or not, but to see your son come along well enough to outrun you.
And you and take out half the field in the process.
You know, things happen.
And the highest point was probably 2 years before that in an IMC modified. We had like a 60% win rate that year. That was probably the best year I ever had.
The next highest point, I suppose, would be seeing my son win the Hutch Nationals the first time, which is something I've never done.
Another one of my highs was a championship that I won over in Clinton. That year was phenomenal. We couldn't do anything wrong that year, and we still sit around a bench race about that year at times.
All of a sudden, our cars aligned really good, and I was wide open. I wasn't going to lift, just started hitting him. It was like the sea party. We just started passing everybody. Before I knew it, they're waving the white flag, and we're taking the lead. And I was thinking, how can I pass him? I just couldn't get by him. And on that day, Dale Earnhardt won, and he won $1 million bonus. And in victory lane, all I could hear was, I want to thank Kenny Wallace. If it weren't for Kenny Wallace, and at that point, that's the highest honor you can ever receive, is to have the greatest race car driver in the world, Dale Earnhardt, 7-time champion. If it weren't for Old Herm, my nickname, I wouldn't have won. So, this many years later, come to find out, I helped Dale Earnhardt win his very last race. And
it's a beautiful morning. It's moments like this that make me.
Future plans are almost always in the back of the mind of the drivers. Some of these dreams involve racing in a bigger, more competitive series or winning championships.
There's always that dream where you hope you get a big car owner come by and support you, or a big factory sponsor. But my probably biggest dream would be to work my way up through the ranks through sprint car racing and dirt track racing.
I want to win a championship. I mean, that's what it's all about. That's what I've always done. I've always been able to win championships and go on to the next thing, really there's only one more next thing, and that's a cup championship.
If I do something bigger, that's up to my wife. My safety is her safety. I enjoy the sport. I enjoy my family at the racetrack. It would be nice to be able to do some traveling, but I've got bills to pay, mortgage. I'd like to try it just one time.
No, I want him to keep doing it, as long as he's having fun with it. But it's just like the grades and the recreation. He's got to make his grades before he goes and plays. And I would look at his life the same way. He has to make a living, take care of his responsibilities, and then, if he's got money left over to play, he can do that.
I'd like to get big enough and do well enough to where we can do some touring series. He's a late model, something like that. I don't know if I want to, do NASCAR or nothing like that. I never raced on asphalt. I don't know if it'd have to be a lot more exciting than what it looks on TV. It looks boring to me.
Some drivers look toward a future of successful racing. For others, the future is uncertain. When you have racing in the blood, it's hard to think about letting go.
I want to race. That's all I've ever wanted to do, and I'm very lucky to be able to do it. But, there comes a time when you gotta say, hey, that enough's enough. And I don't know what you can really put an age on it. I guess it all depends what your body does, what you feel like, whether barring injury, the injury might shut me down. I don't know.
My wife says this is my last year. She said that last year, too. I suppose this will be my last year. I turned 60 last December, and we raced at Jetmore, and the track was so terribly rough, and I used to really like those, and I got tired. I just run out.
I probably will never retire because, I'd be too bored. I don't like to, I don't care nothing about fishing or golfing or hunting or anything.
I'm ready to just kind of hang out. I'm ready to go maybe help CJ a little more and work with him a little bit. And of course, I got lots of grandkids coming up. Maybe one of them might want to race sometime. But I'm going to have parental involvement. I'm not going to take my grandkid and put him in my race car because I'm not going to take that responsibility. I'm going to have the parents take that responsibility. I'll help him out. I'm not going to be the one to to be responsible. I want to be an unresponsible grandfather.
The allure of the track, the people involved, and the dream of winning it all is what keeps bringing everyone back year after year.
The excitement, the adrenaline, and the people. The people are great. You make a lot of good friends doing that. When I got back into racing with this, we all met up again that I hadn't seen him for 10 years, and it was just like, it's, the people are great. They just, yeah, that's most of it.
The reason I'm back here running these dirt races is because it means as much to me to win a 25-lap dirt feature as it does to win a big, you know, NASCAR race. So, you know, Dale Earnhardt said something years ago, there are thousands of great race car drivers all over the United States, and they're, you know, right here at this racetrack we're at, there are some of the greatest drivers in the world that will never make it to NASCAR, and they're here tonight.
I guess everybody's got to be good at something. You know, some people can play golf. Some people can play basketball, baseball, all that kind of stuff. I can race, and I'm pretty good at it. And I guess I just enjoy winning.
I enjoy racing that grassroots level of racing. I think it's as competitive as cup racing. It just doesn't have the resources that cup racing has. You know, there's a lot of good drivers still, you know, across the Midwest, across, you know, the country that can do every bit as much as any of us in a cup series have done. They just haven't got the opportunity.
It's a lifestyle. I planned on being racing all my life. You know, if not driving, I'll be a car owner.
To some, racing is nothing more than drivers making circular laps and turning left the whole time. For those in the sport, the perspective is a bit different.
Come get in the car, for one thing. Just come get in the car, drive it around, see what it takes. People don't understand how you've got to change the car. Every race, there's got to be adjustments made. The modifieds are even worse than the factory stocks. There ain't a whole lot you can do with factory stocks because there's not a whole lot of adjustments. Modifieds, they've got some adjustments on it. You can get a pound of air in the wrong place and can't drive a car.
People think we just go out there and drive around in circles, you know, come and see what's going on the other 6 days of the week. It's not just working there at the shops, also in the pits, between the races, seeing what you need to do between races to make the car better from that last race, seeing how the track's changing.
You know, there's a lot more technical on these cars than you think. You know, they've got to have the offset of their rear wheels, the weight in the right front, the left front. That's all very critical if you, you know, to make these cars handle good.
Get in the car and try it yourself. Football players, basketball players, baseball players, I've done it all, and I have never seen more adrenaline run through my body than jumping behind that wheel.
A hero is a person known for their tremendous courage and sacrifice. To many, those involved in the sport of dirt track racing are just that.
A lot of these guys don't have a lot of money, and they put every dime they make into getting these cars out on track each and every week.
Growing up watching dirt track racing, I just idolized them.
They go pretty fast. When you're a kid, you look up to things like that.
A hero to some. Others call him the bum. But he never stops trying to win. Seven broken bones and two broken homes. I wouldn't change a thing if he could do it again. The bed is the cab of his pickup truck. He's only in it for the buck. He's loved lots of ladies, but he's always had to go. Nothing touches his heart so.
White flag is waving. Donnie Schatz is a half a mile from $50,000. Schatz out of turn two, down the back straightaway. track in turn three. Call him King Tawny, the 26th Tawny Schatz wins the 2009 Kings Royal.
I don't need you around. I don't need you in your town. Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, you just bring me down. Give it to him. No, I don't need you around. I don't need you in your town. Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, you just bring me down. No, I don't need you around. I don't need you in your town. Yeah, as far as I'm concerned, you just bring me down. Yeah. Down. That's right. Yes, you just bring me down. That's right. Oh, 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 yeah. Oh, nah, 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 nah. Oh, oh, oh.
No, I don't think it's an addiction, because they got programs for drugs, don't they? I don't think they have any programs for racing.
Everybody knows the story. He's living life just too damn hard. Through all the fame and the glory, he always took it too far. Living for the moment. Just living for the one thing that makes her want to say.